brought to you by Penguin.
As Good as It Gets, written and read by Romesh Ranganathan. This book is dedicated to my wife Lisa and our wonderful children, although you still haven't read the last one, so I don't know why I bother. Also, it was me who broke the washing machine. Outmaneuvered. I want to be absolutely crystal clear on this. I am not in any position to be offering anybody advice, but that is exactly why I think I'm well placed to do so. I've spent many years reading books advising you how to be more productive, how to be happy, how to crush your goals, and the one thing that has struck me about all of them is that these people are proffering advice from a position of having it nailed. I definitely do not have it nailed. In fact, I think it's fair to say that I'm finding new ways to remove the nails and drive them into my own face. This isn't a book of philosophical pontifications on life. It's more a series of musings on what I think about where I am right now, which is a thought process of a lot of men my age, just before they decide they're going to change their hairstyle, buy a motorbike, or leave their wife. I like my hair, I'd kill myself on a bike, and there is no way any other woman would have me. When I started this book, I hoped it would be something people could relate to and would make them feel better about things. Then I got to the middle of it, and I just hoped it would be amusing. As I approached the final third, all I wanted was to finish the fucking thing. The truth is, like all of us, I properly struggle with adulthood, and am making judgment errors every single day. On our last holiday to Portugal, we started to get frustrated by the fact that our kids were not eating things they themselves had ordered. I wouldn't mind if those things turned up and were horrible, or even significantly different to how they were advertised. What I do find maddening is when you watch your child order something, that thing arrives exactly as it looks on the menu, and then your child informs you that they won't be eating anything because the nuggets smell different. My first instinct is to say, hold your nose then, dickhead, because it feels like our kids are being willfully fussy. My parents were definitely that hard line with me. Eat what you're given, Romesh, or you can starve. But things are different now. The truth is, it's a lot more complicated to be a parent in the modern world, partly because we know so much more about our children. We know, for example, that some children are more sensitive than others to things like smell and noise, and that the way previous generations might have dealt with, or not recognised, those hypersensitivities would more than likely give those children hang-ups for the rest of their lives. My wife apparently hated peas, and was forced by her school to eat every last one of them before she was allowed out to play. To this day, she cannot bear them, to the point where even listening to this would make her feel nauseous. Fortunately, she takes so little interest in what I do that there's no chance of that happening. Lisa sees her pee trauma as evidence that we should be considerate and understanding of kids' fussiness, whereas I see it as evidence that it's her shitty genetics that have led to this problem with her own kids in the first place. Can you inherit a picky eating habit? Other people are a problem too. Restaurants are competitive places for parents. You can guarantee that while your kids smash each other in the face with pizza slices, across at another table will be a family whose children are finishing their risotto, silently putting their cutlery down and exclaiming, "Oh, mummy, the seasoning in that was lovely." And then they all laugh at how charming it is that their kid said something an adult would say, whereas in reality, it's actually really creepy to hear a child say that. And if you did hear an adult say that, you probably wouldn't want to hang out with them either. And then, in the middle of that thought, you're distracted by your glasses being knocked off your face by a bread roll, and you try to bollock your kids, but you can't because your wife is almost pissing herself laughing, I imagine. I occasionally become convinced that our kids behave like this to wind us up. We're on holiday in Dubai recently, which is a really nice place to go as long as you don't mind having a daily series of panic attacks about how much you're spending. We had dinner, then our kids asked us to buy them ice cream. I had, for some reason, decided that rather than just accept this holiday was going to be expensive, I would work out the price of each and everything we were getting, so my catchphrase for the holiday could be, "I cannot fucking believe how much that costs." But much as I was balking at the expense, we were on holiday, and obviously I told the kids they could have ice cream. I watched as they frolicked up to the lovely man at the counter and placed their order, deliberating over a selection of toppings that were arguably excessive. One of the kids came back with an ice cream that had 3 Snickers bars sticking out the top. My only thought was at least that went some way towards clawing back the fortune each of those diabetes inducers had cost us. It was as much as I could do, however, not to hurl the ice cream across the room a few minutes later when, After eating some of the toppings and stirring the ice creams for a bit, they announced they were full. This time, there was no way the ice creams smelt funny or were not what they wanted. They're incredible. But not only had the kids decided they'd had enough, they'd done so much finger-licking and dipping into them that they'd rendered them toxic to anyone else. Had they not done this, I might have contemplated abandoning my veganism to eat them just on financial principle. What ended up happening was that I decided to teach them a lesson about ordering things they didn't want. And that was how I found myself demanding the children finish what they had ordered. It's probably the first time Dubai's holidaymakers have seen children eating ice cream while crying. In Portugal, after Nuggetgate, I decided I was going to tackle this food issue actively. Before I became a parent, I had all these ideals about setting up expectations and making sure the children adhere to them so they grow up with a crystal clear understanding of how to behave. In reality, what happens is that you take them out, they start pissing about, and you're so exhausted you think, is it really such a big deal if they bite that dog? I was of the opinion that we'd let the food thing slide, however, and I proudly told my wife I was taking action. She told me she was really glad to hear it. At the time, I thought that was because she was excited to be inspired by what I was doing as a parent, but now I realise she was just excited about how much of a prick I was going to make of myself. We sat down in a lovely restaurant, and I made some subtle comments about how we should all think carefully about what we were ordering, and maybe we should ask questions of the waiter to make sure we were getting what we really wanted. My wife nodded and agreed. I imagine trying to contain her joy at being able to see all of this go tits up. One of the kids ordered a fish dish. Immediately, alarm bells started ringing. This was going to be a real fish. The fish our son likes is where they take whatever happens to fall off fish and compress it into fish shapes. I explained to him that this was going to be an actual fish, and he sternly informed me that he knew what fish was and that's what he wanted to eat. I said okay and explained that he would have to eat it. This fish dish had now become my hill to die on. I knew I was going to have to make sure my son ate that fish so I could prove my point, educate the kids, but more importantly, try to get some impressed holiday sex from my wife. I steeled myself for the challenge ahead. I looked at my son. He didn't realise it yet, but we were now locked in battle. The fish arrived and it had skin on it. My wife nearly punched the air. She knew she was about to see something pretty special. My son took one look at the fish and said, skin, I can't eat this. Almost exactly as he said this, I glanced across the restaurant and saw a child who had ordered the same dish, lifting the crispy skin and lowering it into his mouth like a hungry shark that was also a smug little shit. I told my son that the fish looked great and he was going to eat it. He refused. He said it was disgusting. I explained to him that he was only saying that because he hadn't tried it and if he wanted to, he would eat it, which is arguably one of the most pathetically circuitous arguments that anyone could come up with. I insisted he try the fish. He agreed, taking a tiny speck of it, putting it into his mouth, and informing me that it was the most disgusting thing he'd ever eaten, which is weird because I once saw him eat a quaver he found behind a car seat. To be fair, I did the same thing when I found an Oreo once, and I found the staleness actually slightly improved it. This was going badly, and I could tell how badly it was going because my wife was smiling. My thinking was, if I could make him eat the fish, he would enjoy it, and I would forever be able to tell him he was being silly every time he refused to eat anything. This was a very tricky moment, and I was starting to feel like the whole holiday hinged on it. I decided that my only option was to bribe him. He would accept the bribe, eat the fish, and his protest would be shattered forever. He was due to get a PlayStation for his birthday, a fact that I find embarrassing even saying here. That gave me the idea. Our children never seemed grateful enough to me. That might seem an odd statement straight after admitting that we were buying one of our sons a PlayStation for his birthday, but we really do try to make sure they value what they have. My parents, after initially spoiling us as young children, fell on hard times, so we were given an appreciation for things by accident rather than by design. In my head, I was always extremely grateful for what I was given, but that could be me looking back through rose-tinted glasses. I'm sure if you spoke to my late father, he'd tell you he didn't know why he bloody bothered. Every generation thinks their kids are terribly behaved. Recently, one of my kids was dancing with his penis out at breakfast, and I looked at him to stop. He caught my eye, smiled, and if anything, started gyrating with more vigour. I then told him to stop, before saying that in my day, my parents would just have to look at me and I would stop misbehaving. Except that wasn't true. That was actually something my dad used to say to me about his childhood when I wouldn't stop messing about. So from that, I can only assume he was a little prick too. I don't think kids should be grateful by default because we as parents have done anything amazing for them. Not at all. They don't owe us anything. I've been a long-term subscriber to the belief that since kids have no say about being brought into the world, the least you can do is make it as easy as possible for them to have the nicest life they can. Sometimes that means you buy them a PlayStation and sometimes it doesn't. That choice is yours. What I do think, though, is that kids should learn to be grateful for what they have and they shouldn't be allowed to take anything for granted. Not least because when your kids are less than grateful for something they're given, it's really embarrassing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.